Welcome back to my channel, and again, thanks for paying attention this far. What we're gonna do right now is kind of go outside of the F-15's comfort zone and move into close combat, or basically just kind of... This is gonna be a two-part video. First off, I'm gonna tell you how to use the F-15's close-in weapons systems. The gun, the Sidewinder missile, and in a pinch, you can use the AIM-7 Sparrow and the AIM-120 AMRAARM as a dogfight missile, although that's not really what they're designed for. It's technically possible, so we'll demonstrate that. Let's change our paint job. Let's keep things consistent here. In the second part of the video, I'm going to talk, I can hear you're thinking right now, if you've been watching this series, first off, again, thank you. And second, you've been watching all these BVR engagements, shooting targets at 15 miles away with an AMRAARM or whatnot, thinking, why would I ever choose, that's so effective. And in DCS right now, nothing can really touch the F-15 in a beyond visual range engagement. So why would you ever get close voluntarily? I'll get to that. Just as a heads up, the second part of the video here may be a little philosophical in nature, so brace for that. If you just want to see how the weapons work, just watch the first half, and let's get right to it. So basically, I've set up three cargo planes here as easy targets, and a flight of four MiG-21s with orders to not fire back at us. Let's set our altitude correctly here at 10,000 feet, just kind of as a nice round number. And here we are again, four Sidewinders, the Mike model, two Sparrow missiles, and two AIM-120s. And I'm going to go over a couple of the things that you should probably have bound to your HOTAS that I kind of glossed over in the earlier videos here. So if you're wondering how to set up your joystick, I have some suggestions, although that's a very personal choice. And as you play through DCS or whatever it is, you're going to figure out something that works better for you. There's no one right way to do all this stuff. There's a lot of personal preference, and what works for you this month may change next month as you evolve as a player. So keep that in mind too. Iced coffee. If you're wondering what I'm drinking, it's almost always iced coffee. Anyway, so close-in weapons in the F-15, as you can see right here, we have the AIM-9. That's a Sidewinder heat-seeking dogfight missile, which has been pretty reliable and pretty accurate, at least historically. And we have the M61A1 20mm Vulcan cannon, which is quite nasty, assuming you can goad somebody into getting close enough to use it. Okay, so we have 8 missiles and 7 targets. Let's see what we can do. Okay, so let's go over the HOTAS binds first. Up here, these are going to be on your top keyboard row. Look, you have two close air combat HUD modes. And this one here, we're going to get over that. You probably won't be using that unless you're in a pinch and you need to do something really quick, or you just kind of want to humiliate somebody with a Sparrow missile, and we'll get to that. I bind all these to my HOTAS. If you only have one button left and need to bind just one, I would go with this one here, number 4, close air combat bore mode, as opposed to vertical scan. They do similar things, but they function a little differently. Another thing you're going to want to bind is C cannon. What that does is set your HUD to cannon mode. It doesn't fire it. It just sets your HUD to gun mode, so you can aim the weapon. You need to bind weapon fire to your trigger, or whatever you want to use for your gun. And weapon release is what you use to fire missiles. So, if you haven't bound these two yet by now, now's the time. And that's pretty much all we need aside from everything else you've already got. All right. So I've got all these targets set to orbit around and not really do anything in response, but they're probably going to launch some countermeasures. So let's find us up a target here. I'm going to go from left to right. And what I'm going to do is, you know, close in like this, there are two ways to engage your target. Whatever weapon you're using, whether it's a Sidewinder or a or the gun, you can use close combat mode with or without radar. Now, as we've probably got under wraps by now, see how my RWR is lit up right here with MiG-29s? If you have your radar on, their radar warning receiver will light up in a similar fashion. So if you want to be all sneaky and you're trying to engage somebody without them knowing you're there, you're going to want to snooze your radar and shut it off like that. You can still arm your Sidewinder. Set your HUD to close combat mode, bore sight. Notice when I did that, my radar automatically turned on, so you may have to shut that off manually. So what close combat mode bore sight does is it puts your, kind of slays your seeker head, kind of faces forward. You can hear that. That's your Sidewinder seeker head. You'll know when it acquires a target when you hear the pitch go up and it gets louder. So we have it in bore sight, boom, like that. See that circle? That means my Sidewinder seeker head has acquired the target. The yellow light here means I'm within good firing parameters. So let's go ahead and fire a Sidewinder and watch what happens. Fox 2. Notice he drops his flares, and that might hit. Smack. Okay. Now this is the AIM-9M, the Mike, which is an all-aspect missile that, you know, the older Sidewinders, like the AIM-9P and even earlier, you had, for it to pick up enough heat signature, you had to get behind your target and look straight up its tailpipe. So you can see the exhaust from the engine. The AIM-9P5, let's go with the AIM-9M, AIM-9 Mike, that has an all-aspect seeker head, so we can detect the heat generated by the friction on the nose of the airplane as it flies through the air, so you can shoot from pretty much any angle. The AIM-9P5 is the older AIM-9P rocket motor with the newer AIM-9M seeker head, so when you're selecting your weapons, you can, you know, choose those. See? No radar. The Sidewinder will still acquire a target. Now let's turn our radar on. It works very much the same way. Boom. Once you get a, you know, see that square shows where your radar is pointing? What that does, and you can even do this in long-range combat mode too. If you go to BVR, you've got your Sidewinders queued up. So I can find our target here. I think my search cone is too narrow. Anyway, if you find a target and lock it up with the radar, it'll slave the Sidewinder seeker head to point in the same direction. So you can use, even though the Sidewinder is infrared guided, you can still use the radar to tell the Sidewinder where the target is, and it'll point its seeker head accordingly. So let's go to radar on. We're going to go to close combat mode with the HUD. Boom. Instant lock. With the Sidewinder, the Sparrow. Two. Smack. And that's a kill. So you can use the Sidewinder either with or without. I kind of prefer to use it without because, again, you don't want to give away your exact position unless you're certain of a kill. And there's no such thing as certain. So, let's move on to doing the same thing, but with vertical scan mode on your HUD. Okay, how that works, you still have your radar on. See that vertical line right there that got added when I switched my HUD? So there's bore sight, and vertical scan. What that does is it sets your radar, it's actually a little more complicated, but basically it's moving up and down along that line. So it gives it a very narrow focus. But if you put a target on that line, it's probably going to lock it up pretty quickly. So why would you want that? Well, imagine yourself in a dogfight. You've got a target over here. on your right wing, what happens? You roll and you turn into him. See how it locked up a target already? I didn't even know that was there. Boom. There you go. You've got your target. Now, which one is this? I think it's another one of the cargo planes. See how I did that? You can unlock the target, put that line on the target. See, it's not only in the HUD, I think it actually extends upward, kind of beyond, kind of way above your nose. Let's unlock it again. Unlock. And as I roll to the right, kind of use roll to, I think it's beaming us actually, so we're not picking it up. But you get the idea. It's a good way to, in a pinch, kind of lock up somebody who you're trying to turn on the inside of. So that's vertical scan mode, and it's pretty useful. I tend to use bore sight, but if you're in a turning fight, vertical scan's pretty handy. So let's select our AIM-7 Sparrow. Like I said, this is not designed as a dogfight missile, but as long as we've got something within our dynamic launch zone here, we've got a good lock. Fox 1. As long as we keep that target locked, that Sparrow's got a decent chance of hitting. Smack. Hit it pretty hard, too. I'm surprised to kill it with one shot. So he'll be hitting the ground shortly. And in the same way, you can use close combat mode, queue up your AMRAARMs instead, and do very much the same thing. All you have to do is put the target in kind of the search cone of the radar, whether it's in vertical scan or bore sight, and the radar is going to automatically lock up the first thing it sees. So keep that in mind too if you're in a PvP scenario or with friendlies around. You know, be sure of your target before you fire on it. Let's let's go to the visual range mode so I can find a target more easily here. There we go. Cheat a little bit for training purposes only, as I say too much. There's our cargo plane. I don't know exactly why we're not detecting it here. I think it's probably beaming us. So I'm just going BVR mode to find it, and once we find it, we'll go to close combat mode in the HUD, thus, and go from there. Ah, okay, looks like that plane may have landed already. Yeah. He's on the taxiway. That's my fault for building the mission all weird. Anyway, let's see if we can find those MiGs. Flight of 4 MiG-29s heading away from us. There they are. Okay, so we could lock them up with our radar right now. Go to track while scan mode. We can pick them up. They're heading to the left, so we'll swing in behind them. I'll use, actually, no, let's use the gun. Now, remember, too, that radar-guided missiles, such as the AMRAARM and even the Sparrow, they have a minimum range. So when you lock them up, and you lock up a target, assuming I can find these guys again, take note that even though I know they're here, I cannot see them on radar. And we'll get back to that. Like I said, we're going to get a little philosophical here. See how they can see me and I can't see them? I don't know why. Are they too low, too high? What's going on? They should be at about 10,000 feet, which means I'm higher than them. If they're following the orders I gave them in the mission builder. I can't see them. And that's a very important note to make. Ah, tally. I see him. He's probably going to be moving in for a gun solution since, Alright. Fight's on. Let's go to gun mode. Close combat mode. Vertical scan. I've got my gun selected. So I press C. Actually, I've got that bound in my HOTAS. He'd fire a missile at me. He's not supposed to do that. Alright, so there's our Miggy Wiggy. What I'm going to try to do now is a radar-assisted gun solution. And getting into firing parameters is the hard thing, but once you do, the gun is actually pretty simple and intuitive. I'm trying not to turn too hard here. Bleed all my speed out. Alright. Ah! Come on, radar, lock him up, lock him up, lock him up. Boom. All you have to do, see that pipper I got? That little thing that looks like a clock? You put that on your target and you squeeze the trigger. That's all there is to it. Now, making that happen, of course, is the fun part. Come on, lock him. See how well he turns? You force an overshoot. See if I can do a bit of a lag roll here on him. And boom. Not much left after that, is there? So that's a radar-assisted gun solution. Now, again, if you want to be sneaky and shut your radar off like I just did here, your gun picture changes. All you get, see that cross right there? That is your gun bore line, and it kind of gives you a little bit of a gun sight. So it shows you where your gun is going to go, more or less, but it doesn't calculate lead. So if you're going to do it this way, you got to be really sure of your shot. Practice your gun engagements, and think of it like a shotgun. That's what I do. Get in real close, make sure you can't miss, and just light it up. You notice when I shoot, that's not a laser beam. That's, well, MIG on the... MIG on my 6. I'm pretty sure I can outclimb him, so let's see what happens. I told you to weapons hold, sir. Alright. I may or may not get shot down here. I'm really slow, dead in the water. But of course the F-15 has massive engines. And honestly, I've never really used the gun without locking the radar, so let's see what we can do here. Maybe I can get him, maybe I can't. Turn on our ECM and see what that does to their targeting solution. Incidentally.
Left engine fire. Left engine fire.
Let's start that all over again, because that kind of pissed me off a little bit.
Left engine.
That just kind of goes to my next point. Like I said, we're going to get a little philosophical here. Yeah, he got me with his gun. Oh, in the mission editor, I did program them to not return fire, but it looks like he did. Alright, so let's get into that. I'm just going to goof around here and talk a little bit. Philosophical mode engage. Now, if you're not interested in the kind of history of... Well, anyway, stick around if you want to. So, now that you know kind of like how to use the F-15's close-in weapons, you may be wondering why you would ever need to do that. I just kind of demonstrated that for you. But if you've been following this video series and you put in some practice, you can see how a kind of halfway decent virtual F-15 pilot can just absolutely dominate the airspace beyond visual range, not only score kills, but more importantly sometimes, place a stranglehold of control over over the airspace in which it flies. Now the question follows then is why you'd ever want to get close enough to use your sidewinders or the gun at all. You know, as they say, if you ever get up in a merge where you're in close in against a MiG, you've screwed up somehow. Well, that may be true. There's other reasons why you want to get close in. The preferred reason is that you're attacking a low threat target, such as we did earlier, a cargo plane, a bomber, AWACS helicopter, something like that, and you don't want to use your AMRAARMs on it. That's a good reason. Another reason is maybe you just ran out of AMRAARMs, and despite the bad odds, you decide that you need to press your attack regardless of the danger. Depends on your mission objectives and whether you're willing to put in that risk or not. The third reason, and more relevant to what we're talking about here, is that it's likely at some point, especially in multiplayer servers, that a red side virtual pilot is going to force a merge on you whether you like it or not. So we need to get into a bit of Cold War history here. Compared to Western-style fighters, like this, which have a tendency to rely on their own radar sets and kind of operate fairly autonomously, kind of the Soviet-style, Soviet-era fighters and their descendants, like the MiG-29, Sukhoi-27, kind of designed with the concept that they would be closely coordinated with GCI, or Ground Controlled Intercept. That kind of radar environment. The Warsaw Pact nations actually developed a really sophisticated integrated air defense system, which had a bunch of radar sets, SAM launchers, and interceptors. So Russian planes would fly in close contact with the GCI, who would talk them into the intercept course or kind of set up an ambush for enemy aircraft. As we discussed when we discovered covered countermeasures, aircraft without active radar on don't trigger an enemy's RWR system, and therefore they are harder to detect. Combined with sneaky tactics like hiding in valleys and mountains, or flying really low in ground clutter or sea clutter, MiGs and Sukhois have a nasty way of hiding until their prey is flying overhead and then pouncing on them undetected, firing IR-guided missiles, which again trigger no launch warning. So you see those mountains? As powerful as our radar can't see through the mountains. So in those nooks and crannies and all that stuff, let's say we've got an objective out there over the horizon, we're going to have to overfly these mountains. So what's in those mountains? Who knows? Is our radar going to be able to see it? Also imagine this. If you look at our Eagle kind of side on, and imagine a cone sticking out from its nose, which represents the radar search pattern. Now, if you look at the mountains below, that cone may not be searching down into those valleys until it's too late. So, maybe you've seen my BVR videos or ones like it, and you're thinking that you can dominate anything that dares to challenge your mighty F-15 in the open skies. Well, guess what? The red side DCS pilots, like their real-world counterparts, know full well what an F-15 can do, and only new or foolhardy MiG driver will ever willingly go toe-to-toe BVR with your F-15. Unless, of course, they have something tricky up their sleeve, like a teammate sneaking up on you from below in the clutter, or pincing you from a beam where your radar can't see, or maybe they're just amazing tacticians. Either way, they have a nasty way of forcing you into a within-visual-range merge, where their planes hold more of the cards. So thus we get back to our real-world parallels. In the 1960s, NATO-aligned nations, especially the U.S., thought that the days of the close-in dogfight were over, because planes like the F-4 and their long-range capabilities would surely shoot down any opponents at long range before the merge ever happened. Vietnam clearly demonstrated this was a complete folly. North Vietnamese Air Force using so-called inferior aircraft, like the comparatively simple MiG-17, MiG-21, to get into a close turning fight against U.S.-built interceptors that were never designed to handle that kind of thing. This forced a kind of a reevaluation of how U.S. pilots were trained and how fighters were designed. So we got stuff like the F-15 and the F-16, which can not only manage, you know, long-range fights, but also handle themselves pretty well in a dogfight as well. So in short, while BVR is the preferred way to go, combat is very situational. And in DCS, like real life, you can't really control what the enemy does. And you're gonna eventually be forced outside of your ideal comfort zone. Therefore, you gotta be prepared for everything, you know? So, train your BFM, your basic fight maneuvers, study the dogfight, and be ready with that gun. Sukhoi and MiG pilots at DCS are quite used to smashing complacent F-15 pilots who panic or react poorly once the fight gets close. Your best odds, then, are to keep a few cards up your sleeve. When things get close in, be ready to engage immediately with the best BFM you can muster, and surprise them when you don't go into a panic like they expected. You'll have a non-zero chance, therefore, of surviving. And imagining the surprise when you splash an enemy that you quote-unquote shouldn't have beaten is worth every second you spent training your skills. And in DCS, as in real life, there's always more you could learn. There's always a better way to do things. There's always a new challenge.